ओके सर। इलेवन फाइव फोर थ्री टू वन।
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, वी वेलकम यू ऑल टू ऑर्थो टीवी ऑनलाइन इन एसोसिएशन विद अवाना मेडिकल। टुडेज वेबिनार इज ऑन नी प्रिजर्वेशन विच इज द हॉट टॉपिक ऑफ दिस ईयर, आई थिंक नॉट ओनली ऑफ दिस मंथ बट ऑफ दिस ईयर। एंड इनफैक्ट टुडे ओनली आई हैव सीन एंड डिस्कस्ड अ केस विद डॉक्टर नागराज शेट्टी अबाउट अ नी प्रिजर्वेशन केस। सो टू इंट्रोड्यूस आर मेन कोर्स चेयरमैन डॉक्टर किरण आचार्य, ही इज द यूनिट हेड एट द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ऑर्थोपेडिक्स इन मणिपाल, जस्ट अ मोमेंट, जस्ट अ मोमेंट, इन कस्तूरबा मेडिकल कॉलेज इन मणिपाल। एंड ही टीचेस अ लॉट ऑफ अंडर ग्रेजुएट एंड पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट स्टूडेंट्स एंड इज ऑल्सो इन्वॉल्व इन गाइडिंग पीएचडी प्रोजेक्ट वर्क्स। दैट मीन्स अ लॉट ऑफ रिसर्च। ही हैज गॉट मोर देन 20 इयर्स ऑफ ऑर्थोपेडिक एक्सपीरियंस, 22 टू बी एग्जैक्ट। ही इज अ एस्टीम्ड फैकल्टी एंड गेस्ट लेक्चरर एट वेरियस रीजनल, नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंसेस। And ongoing research projects are multi-ligament injuries of the knee biomechanics, osteoarthrosis, cartilage injuries, osteoporosis, osteoporosis, pain management, fracture healing, biomaterials, stem cell therapy. So, and to introduce further, Dr. Vikash Kapoor, who's a course co-chairman, he also has 22 years of orthopedic experience. He's a senior consultant orthopedic surgeon and director of Medica Institute of Orthopedic Sciences in Kolkata. His areas of interest are joint replacement and arthroscopy and sports medicine. He was invited as guest joint replacement surgeon by the present health minister of Bangladesh to perform joint replacement. He has been a faculty and speaker at many national and international conferences and has had various research papers in his name in national and international journals. With this, I will stop my screen share and hand over the meeting to Dr. Kiran Acharya to introduce today's topic in detail and the other speakers.
Good afternoon to all of you. I also welcome my panelists, my co-chairman, Vikash Kapoor, panelists Clement Joseph and Nagaraj Shetty, and speakers of the day. I will introduce them as I follow them for their presentations. Nagaraj Shetty works in Lilavati and Nanavati Hinduja hospitals in Manipur, in Mumbai. He also has 15 years of experience in arthroscopy and joint replacement, and he has done various fellowships. I welcome him for this meet.
Thank you.
And knee preservation, revolutionary advancements, and next gold standards. It's a very interesting topic because whichever literature you read about ACL, meniscus, or cartilage lesions, they tend to become irrelevant in about 10 years' time because the techniques would have evolved so well. And we have a better understanding of biology, biomechanics, and as well as we have a very efficient fixation systems and hardware with us. So setting the next gold standards is important. And it's also important that we document these procedures, which may not be in big numbers with each of the consultants. So we need to have a national database to have this documented for later analysis. Without much delay, I request Purna Chandra Tejaswi, who is from Yashoda Hospital, Hyderabad, who has done various fellowships in Singapore, Germany, Italy, and Canada, to speak on all inside ACL reconstruction. Over to you, Purna Chandra Tejaswi.
Thank you, sir. I was an alumni of KMC Mangalore, and I used to visit you and and the contest to see your surgeries.
I remember.
So, can you, is my presentation visible?
Yes.
A very good afternoon to all the viewers. As per interview, I am Pranay, and I have been sports medicine and reconstructive arthroscopy based at Yashoda Hospital in Hyderabad. First of all, I used to like to thank the medicals and arts. As you all know, there have been many techniques and fixation options that have been advocated for ACL reconstruction of the injured knee. However, the basic goal remains the same, that is to reconstruct an anatomically identical ACL to give good stability and good functional outcome to our patients. So what is an all-inside ACL technique? Although all-inside ACL technique was introduced to us around 20 years back, this was popularized by Lubovitz et al. Around 2011. Some features of this technique include closed socket tunnels, dual suspensory fixation, decreased bone removal, and apparently smaller skin incisions. Here, we use suspensory buttons in place of the usual screws that we use in the conventional technique. Nowadays, the adjustable loop buttons that we use or the second generation buttons, what we call, do have the adjustable loop, the advantage of which is that the loop can be tightened even after the graft is fixed. This said and done, there are many apprehensions about this new technique. Some people tell that this has a steep expertise that requires steep expertise, or some people tell that this has a steep learning curve compared to the conventional technique. However, I would like to disagree with to this to a certain extent, and most in the subsequent slides, mostly I'll try to reason why this novel technique is very easy, reproducible, and versatile at the same time. So the first thing here is the graft choice. So what is the graft that we use for an all-inside ACL? Is it similar to the conventional technique? Here, the most important thing is most of the times we use a quadrupled or a five-stranded semitendinosus. Most of the times we spare the gracilis tendon. However, most often than not, as is usual in our population, especially in the middle-aged females, the graft size or the diameter is inadequate. In such cases, a quadrupled semitendinosus and gracilis tendon can be used. So what does the gracilis pairing give advantages? Studies show that it increases the strength and results in better proprioception of the injured knee. Although more importantly, this can be used for other ligament reconstructions or to add an ALL if the need be. This said and done, there are different studies as well which show that there is no difference in pain scores or laxity tests postoperatively when an isolated semitendinosus or a semitendinosus in combination with gracilis is taken. So we need not hesitate to harvest a gracilis tendon if the diameter is inadequate. The most important part of this operation is the graft preparation, which is quite different from the conventional technique. The end aim is to prepare a tendon that is 6 to 6.5 centimeters in length, which is quite smaller to the conventional technique. Usually a diameter between 8 to 9.5 millimeter is preserved. Especially in the younger adolescent or the pediatric age group, I prefer to use the compression tubes which downsizes the graft diameter by a 0.5 or 1 millimeter. What does this do? This helps us to create smaller tunnels using smaller retrograde drill bits. This in turn allows us to have a very good prospect of the graft into the tunnel. And also this leads to graft re-expansion and better integration or faster integration. How do we prepare the graft? This is pictorial demonstration from the original Lubovitz paper. First, the graft is loaded in linkage with the ACL, femoral and tibial tight ropes onto the graft prep station. The graft ends are held by hemostats and wrapped around the hooks of the graft preparation station. Usually, a high-strength suture, I use a number 2 fiber wire and that is passed through the center of each looped graft. Then, the suture-free ends are crossed and wrapped around the graft. Then, the first suture is tied in a wrapped cinch fashion. Then what do we do? After this, we add another suture in a similar manner immediately next to the first suture. Two additional sutures are placed cinching the other side of the graft. Hence, the final construct is a robust 6 to 6.5 centimeter graft, usually a bit thicker than the usual graft that we use for the conventional technique, with linked ACL femoral and ACL tibial tight ropes on either side. So next, we progress on to the femoral socket preparation. How do we do this? The aim of this is to prepare a 20 millimeter socket in anatomically identical position in the femur. Most of the times, the 20 millimeter socket is fixed for this procedure. There are two techniques. The antromedial portal technique is similar to the conventional technique, and the other one is the retrograde technique where we use the retrograde drills. I prefer to use the antromedial technique through an accessory antromedial portal, and I use a star tip pin which allows me to drill a 4 millimeter tunnel for the tightrope sutures to go inside and measure the lateral femoral condyle at the same time. Once this is done, I over-ream it with appropriate sized reamer to get a 20 millimeter socket. So next, we progress to tibial tunnel preparation. This socket is created in a retrograde manner. So the aiming guide, I prefer to use a thermal cautery device to identify the landmark and to preserve the tibial stump so that my new graft is coming from underneath it without damaging the graft. After the aiming guide is placed at the correct location, the retrograde reamer is drilled, and once it exits the inner cortex, the bullet is punched in so as to hold on to the outer tibial cortex. Next, the flip cutter or the retrograde reamer is flipped and reamed in a retrograde manner up to 25 to 30 mm. This is indicated by the rubber ring that is flushed with the bullet. The flip cutter is flipped and taken out of the tibial tunnel. Next is the passage of the loops for the shuttling of the graft. Here, this is different in comparison with the conventional technique that we use two separate loops, one into the femoral tunnel and one into the tibial tunnel. We need to use two separate color threads for both tibial and femoral tunnel so as to avoid confusion. First, the tibial tunnel is passed, and next the femoral tunnel, and it is important that both the sutures are not entangled and both come out of the antromedial portal. Next, the prepared graft is shuttled through the antromedial portal into the femoral tunnel, and the tunnel and the graft is fixed at 20 millimeter by flipping the button on the femoral side. Once this is confirmed, then the graft is passed to the tibial side, and after taking the knee through cyclical motion, the knee is the graft is fixed on the tibial side with the button. Through usage of the adjustable loop, as I said previously, we can adjust the tensioning of the graft even after the graft is fixed on tibial and femoral tunnels. So coming to the clinical results, all inside technique is backed by sound biomechanical and histographic studies leading to that show that there is good graft integration and there is good graft strength as well. Most of the clinical studies, as you can see here, show that the results are equivalent to conventional technique in the medium term or the long term group. However, many studies, especially the RCT published by Lubowitz et al. And another one published in Arthroscopy Journal in 2016, show that the retrograde drilling leads to less bone edema, less bone loss, which consequently lead to less postoperative pain in the early post-op period. So this, in combination with less bone loss, soft tissue preserving, make this technique more desirable. What are the other advantages that are unique to this procedure? So this is more suitable for the pediatric age group, especially with the age specific jigs available. We can in fact easily take horizontal tunnels by sparing the epiphyses both in the femoral and the tibial bone. So in revision cases, when we find it difficult to remove the hardware and the tunnel, there is total tunnel mismatch between the old and the new tunnel, we can just leave the old hardware inside and make this revision case more elegant and easy. So whenever additional procedures are required, like a high tibial osteotomy, this procedure makes it very easy that we can in fact drill the tibial tunnel through one of the holes in the plate that we or the implant that we use for fixing the high tibial osteotomy, and which makes it less crowding if we use a screw at the bottom. So this is definitely useful in multi-ligament cases where we tend to use a lot of implants. Usage of these buttons on either side for multi-ligaments makes the technique more elegant and more easy. These are some of the advantages that are unique to this procedure. So in summary, all inside ACL is a soft tissue and bone preserving surgery. Most of the times a single hamstring is required, which in turn leads to preserved proprioception and increased strength. More importantly, this tendon can be used for other procedures. Most probably, according to me, this might become the gold standard for ACL reconstruction in children because of its ability to create horizontal tunnels and spare the physis every single time. It is definitely beneficial in complex multi-ligament cases and whenever we need to do additional procedures such as a high tibial osteotomy or a unicompartmental knee along with an ACL reconstruction. Further, many studies as published by Adrian Wilson et al. Show that the complication rate is equivalent to the conventional technique. Thank you all.
Thank you, Purnachandra. That was a very clear presentation of all inside ACL reconstruction.
Thank you.
Vikash, you'd like to add anything?
No, I think it is a matter of just fitting the graft and drilling less, which makes it very attractive. And the whole premise of doing an ACL is to have a press-fit graft, which all of us have understood, as most of the implants lose their validity or whatever in 3 to 6 months' time. So initial bone preservation, of course, is the biggest USP. I'm not sure about the pediatric age group since I have not used this in any pediatric age group yet, but I'm sure with an horizontal tunnel, there is curvature which we would like to avoid. But I think we'll come to discussions part later on. We would progress to, I think, Clement.
Yes.
The topic is on my favorite again, internal and external bracing in knee stability and rehab. Clement, over to you. I'm inviting
Clement,
you.
Clement works in SIMS Hospital, Chennai. He has got a 20 years of experience in arthroscopy.
Yes.
And various limb reconstructive procedures. He has done his fellowship from Singapore, Italy, Finland and UK. Clement?
An extremely well-known and a very versatile colleague of mine.
Yes.
Over thanks, Kiran, and thanks, Vikash, for the kind words of introduction. Of course, joint protection and joint preservation has been a key interest to me. So in this case, they have given a different topic, internal and external bracing in joint and ligament protection. So I'll be showing you a few cases where we've been using internal bracing to support our ligament. And also, I would like to highlight the importance of external braces to protect your joint as well as your ligaments. We all know that unstable knees leads to arthritis. Ligament protection during healing, repair, reconstruction, and recovery is very important in joint preservation. So those days we used to use external bracing like POPs and braces. Now the emerging concept is internal bracing, which gives something like a 24/7 support for your reconstructed and repair ligaments. In my practice, I routinely use it for ACL. During ACL, when I do a primary repair, I add internal bracing using fiber tapes. Whenever the graft is very thin and an obese patient, probably I may have internal bracing to give something like a seat belt effort. I don't over tighten the brace. And MCL repair and reconstructions, I routinely add nowadays. In some cases of lateral collateral ligament repair, an acute scenario, probably I may use it. And also to reinforce PLC grafts. And most importantly, nowadays, we started using an ankle, which allows them a little bit early weight bearing than 2 or 3 months of non-weight bearing when you do an ATFL repair alone. So coming to this case, so this is a chronic MCL laxity with multiple episodes of instability and with a suspected partial ACL tear, but the ACL was good. So this is how we did a reconstruction. The hamstring was harvested. The soft tissue plane was established just above the superficial MCL. And then in that plane, the medial epicondyle is being exposed. And just proximal and posterior to the medial epicondyle, I put a guide wire. And just above the hamstring tendon, another guide wire very close to the posterior medial border. And then we pass an ethibond loop in that plane. The loop is encircled around the K wire. And then wound around the next wire, check for isometry and link changes. And then the proximal femoral tunnel is ringed, only one cortex with 6 millimeter rima. And then the distal tibia is also ringed unicortically. And then a bead pin is passed across the far cortex and the ethibond suture is looped. Now one end of the semitendinosus is loaded into the tibia and then fixed with a interference screw like this. It's very important not to bury the screw. Sometimes the screw can slip into the medullary tunnel. Then the graft is marked at the point and also the depth of insertion is marked 2 centimeter and the further 1 more 2 centimeter mark is made. And the tightrope loop is put in the central mark and then the loop is sutured around the tightrope. And then using an ethibond loop suture, the button is flipped across the far cortex Now the button is locked. Now by shortening the loop, the graft is being taken inside. So this finishes your superficial MCL limb. Now posteromedially, just a centimeter below the joint line, a suture anchor is inserted for fixing the posterior oblique ligament graft. Here you can see the sutures are tied over the graft, and then the graft is folded over and the sutures are once again tied. Now the laxity is being tested. You can still tighten the graft because you are using an adjustable loop. Now I am putting one more knotless fiber tack anchor here, and now the repair suture is taken into the fiber tack anchor, and now the knot is loop is maintained. The fiber tape is loaded into the loop. Then the fiber tape is taken to the femoral epicondyle region. Once again, the depth of insertion is marked. Now the eyelet is kept in the 2 centimeter depth mark. The fiber tape is inserted, and then the swivel lock anchor is inserted, fixing the fiber tape. Now this technique is called the tensionable internal brace. Now I can still tighten the fiber tape by pulling on the repair suture of the knotless fiber tack anchor. Now this procedure has given a really good stable MCL, and the advantage being the patient can be mobilized. I also tend to use internal bracing when we do a primary MCL repair, as in this case, the torn proximal part of the MCL is sutured. The sutures are taken into the swivel lock anchor. The swivel lock anchor is inserted along with the fiber tape. Then the fiber tape is taken into the tibial aspect and fixed just above the hamstring tendon along the posteromedial crest. And a next illustration is a pediatric injury with the meniscus and the partial ACL tear with the Lachman 1 plus. So we decided to do a primary repair and internal bracing. So this is how the internal bracing I use in pediatric age group. We do a retrograde passage of the button. The button doesn't pass from the notch to outside, but rather it is taken from outside the femur, and the loop is taken inside the joint. And then the loop is taken out through the tibia. Then adjustable button, ABS button is locked here. Then further, you can take sutures from the ACL stump. Those sutures can be taken through the tunnel, and it can be tied along with one of the sutures, tensioning sutures of the tetra button here. So, okay. These videos are, I don't think they are running here. So, I'll just run from this presentation here. Okay. So here the first step is to pass a bead pin. So we are not using a 4.5 reamer across the growth plate, just a 2.4 mm bead pin, and using a spinal needle through the same track, an Ethibon suture is introduced. And then here you can see from the joint, we have passed a bead pin like this here. And then the bead pin is track is enlarged by using a 4.5 reamer, and not through the bone, but just to open up the IT band here, and then to know the depth of the soft tissue on the femoral side. And now here you can see the T-bone loop is taken out through the bead pin across the femur. And what we do in this case is we elongate this tightrope button loop, which is 5 centimeters to start with. So this loop can be elongated into 10 or 12 centimeter. Then here you can see the fiber, the leading sutures are loaded. The loop is loaded into the Ethibon loop, which can be pulled retrograde into the joint. So we'll be seeing it now. Here you can see the loop is being taken out, and then from the button, the depth of soft tissue is marked. So we know that if this soft mark reaches the skin, that means the button is sitting on the bone. This is the view from inside. The loop is taken out through the tibial tunnel here, and then further sutures are passed through the ACL stump using a scorpion device, a lasso loop suture is made, and these sutures are taken out through another loop which has been kept in the femoral tunnel, and the ACL stump is pulled and then tied with the leading sutures of the button. Here the loop is taken out of the tibia, The loop is loaded into an ABS button. As you can see, as we pull the tensioning strands on the femoral side, the loop here gets shortened, stabilizing the knee. Now, the sutures which have been taken from the ACL stump are being tied to one of the white tensioning sutures of the tetra button. So in this way, you can give an internal brace without the need for fiber tape, and also you can use the tensioning sutures of the endo button to suture the stump of ACL. Further, to produce a healing response, I also do a multiple microfracture or drilling of the notch so that the healing can be enhanced by the bone marrow. So this is the confirmation on CT scan. So coming to the external braces in ligament protection, so I don't use routinely after an ACL reconstruction, because most of the studies show that the braces after ACL reconstruction doesn't contribute anything to the success of the surgery. But some studies have showed mild to moderate control of tibial internal rotation when you're using the ACL brace. So in my practice, I reserve the brace for ACL reconstructed patient in case the fixation has been not so good, very poor bone, the screw is a bit weak, and in cases of revision where we already had a lot of tunnel widening, and also in obese patients whom we can expect some failures. So ACL reconstruction doesn't routinely need the use of a brace, but in case of PCL reconstruction, I tend to use the brace for at least 3 to 4 months time, because PCL is under a lot more stress because the gravity is always acting on the PCL, pulling the tibia down, and you have to use a brace that can counter the posterior sag. As you can see here, this brace should have straps, adjustable straps on the proximal aspect of the posterior part of the tibia, which can be tightened to correct the posterior sag. And also, after MCL reconstruction, we use this kind of hinge knee brace, which allows early mobilization and weight bearing. And these patients are advised a regular brace during the night time. But when they are awake and ambulant, probably this kind of hinge knee brace can help in their mobility and exercises. And another concept which I've been using is using those unloading brace to protect the collateral ligament repair. So in case if you want to really protect your MCL repair, you can use lateral ONE, which kind of pushes the tibia inwards, producing a varus stress, which may be good for your repaired MCL. Similarly, if you're doing a PLC reconstruction or repair, the lateral structure repair can be protected by MJOA unloading brace, which kind of produces a valgus stress, which is good for the healing PCL or PLC reconstructed knees. In case of joint preservation, the medial unloading braces have been very useful. There are complex braces as on the right side, and there are simple braces as shown on the left side. So just simple wraparound braces with clickable adjustments. So I use these devices mainly for assessing the outcome of proposed high tibial osteotomy. If the patient is above 50 and you really want to know how these patients are going to respond to your high tibial osteotomy, I ask them to use this brace for a few hours. If they can buy and use it for free a few weeks, it is also advisable because they are expensive. We keep these braces in our institution. We make them wear and ask them to use it for an hour or two. Then they come back and tell the improvement is good or not. If they show good improvement, it's implied that after high tibial osteotomy, they are the candidates which will do very well after HTO. And the joint preserving surgery is like medial meniscus root repair. Of course, for young people with varus, you will be doing root repair with high tibial osteotomy. But for elderly patients whom you don't want to do too many procedures, but you can repair the root and protect the repair with the brace intermittently for quite a few months time. And also following a cartilage repair in the middle age, where the alignment is near normal, you don't want to do a HTO, still you want to unload the medial joint for a few months, you can still use an external unloading brace for these patients. And most importantly, these lesions can actually heal and improve the sonk lesions and the tibial stress, which you see in osteoarthritic cases. Many times, these repairs can be a cause for severe pain. I just go back to the next presentation. I'm sorry, I don't know why this is not opening here. These braces can be very helpful in unloading these lesions for a few weeks to a few months. And many times I have seen people who are suffering so much with this sonic lesions and the bone marrow lesions improve very well after a period of non-weight-bearing ambulation followed by an unloading knee brace. We can postpone the knee replacement for many years as well. As for the braces for patellar femoral issues, I don't use them because there are a number of braces, even from the same company, you can see there are so many models available for patellar problems. I don't tend to use them at all. Rather, I use a lot of patellar taping my patients. So patellar femoral braces, I don't have any experience. To conclude, internal bracing has been a very useful technique, especially in treating acute knee repairs to protect the repair as well as to augment your reconstructed ligaments. External bracing can be helpful in ligament reconstruction, especially collateral ligament reconstruction and posterior cruciate ligament reconstruction. And also in select cases, it can be a very useful adjunct in your joint preserving procedures. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Clement. Now I invite Rajiv Gupta. He's from Jaipur Sports Injury Center to speak to us about limb alignment and ACL reconstruction. Paris, antibial slope, etc.
Thank you, Kiran sir, and good afternoon to everyone. Today I am going to talk on limb alignment and ACL reconstruction, I'm going to talk on varus deformities with tibial slope problems. And still we have more lot of unhappy patients after ACL reconstruction. Why? There is a lot of reasons are there, especially recurrent instability. And some patients they may have infections, stiffness, arthritis is one of the major problem, and unexplained pain they feel. And the associated problem, of course, there is a laxity which is hidden, missed, whatever it is, posterolateral complex insufficiency or meniscal deficiency. And out of this, I think alignment and osteoarthritis is one of the major reason which is very much, it is not much discussed. If we talk about recurrent instability, what I mean is early or late graft failure, maybe because of trauma, second injury, or there is a malpositioned tunnels and associated missed posterolateral complex injuries and failure of incorporation of your new graft. And again, malalignment is again one of the major reason for all these after trauma for failure of graft. This paper, they studied cohort of French, Norwegian 3-4 cohort they studied, and still they did not discuss about the alignment. They go through the reason for the ACL failure, it was technical, traumatic, biological infection and others, but no discussion, no data was on alignment. There is a patient, a 38-year-old female, first index surgery was done 5 years back. She had again complained of instability. The main complaint was instability. On examination, there was a clear-cut Leishman positive and of course pivot shift was there. This is of her weight-bearing x-ray. I don't have an scanogram for this patient, but we can appreciate with this x-ray that the patient has reduced medial compartment and there is a opening of the lateral compartment. That shows that it is a double varus. And there is a button of index surgery with on both sides. And this is MR scan. We can appreciate that medial meniscus is coming out from the joint. That shows that the medial compartment is reduced in space. What I did, we did medial open wedge osteotomy and keep the core at the center of intercondylar notch. Why? Because this patient has main complaint of instability, not the pain. The primary concern was instability, not the arthrosis. And on intra-op finding, it was the damage of the cartilage on the posteromedial part under the meniscus. And this was single stage with osteotomy with ACL reconstruction. Again, similar, one female, again, housewife, 40-year-old, had ACL injury 2 years back, get operated, again, complain of pain and instability after 6 months of index surgery. Same picture, it was her standing x-ray. The joint is not opening too much. This is the main problem, is reduced joint space. It was a primary varus, not as much thrust, varus thrust was there. And this is her MRI, no graft is there. And this is what, again, what I did. I did a single sitting outside in and with the flip cutter, and on the medial, on the same side, it was a coronal plane osteotomy. No change in the slope. And I think then comes, why should an osteotomy be considered in ACL deficiency knee? We can discuss on two planes. One is sagittal and one is coronal plane deformities. Let's discuss with first most commonest problem is genu varum or varus deformity. If we go through this paper by Garrett in American Journal of Sports Medicine, the varus alignment increases the force in ACL reconstructed ligament, whether it is a primary or it is a reconstructed graft. If there is a too much lateral opening on the lateral aspect of ligaments or soft tissue, that is give rise to more lateral thrust. And if we see this graph without ACL and 10 degree of flexion with full weight bearing, we see that lateral joint line opening is maximum. That shows that 10 degree of flexion, not in extension, the ACL has maximum strain, or with more opening on the lateral joint line, that keeps ACL graft at risk. What is the clinical relevance of this? It is not necessary that always varus alignment, if is there, then you need osteotomy. If it is there, varus thrust with unstable symptomatic anteroposterior instability, I think we should think upon valgus osteotomy to decrease the risk of failure of new reconstructed graft. If we go through different authors, they studied and they keep the question of failure of ACL reconstruction, why it was there. This is a Moon's Mars group. Again, the alignment is the major issue with this. And it was 4% around. And one 2013, again, varus deformity in revision cases of ACL reconstruction, and the failure was why it was in 19% there was a varus deformity. Noah's 2006, again the failure reason, it was a big number, 25% of patient in their study group has varus deformity. That shows that it is a very common problem and it is we missed sometimes. What is varus deformity? We have varus thrust. It is the opening of lateral compartment in stenosis phase of gait. This is what we call varus thrust. And if we have lax lateral soft tissue or lateral collateral ligaments, that causes more weight on the medial compartment and gives rise to more functional varus deformity. In this picture, if we have varus deformity with lax lateral structures, that if we reconstruct the new ACL, and this varus thrust again causes more stress on the lateral compartment, and opening of the lateral compartment causes again damage to the new reconstructed ACL. That's why if we have increased lateral laxity, then we can have the more load over the ACL, ALL and PLC structure and give rise to failure in the reconstructed new ligament. What is primary double varus and triple varus? If we talk about this, primary varus we know only because of tibiofemoral geometry, not any problem, no laxity on the lateral side. If we have double varus, that shows that patient has mild varus thrust with insufficiency or there is a laxity of lateral collateral ligaments or lateral side structures. And triple varus is a with recurvatum, that is now lateral structures are not supporting the tibia on the posterolateral side. And most of the time it is a combination of varus, I mean is a combination of bony and soft tissue. That's why we have both ligamentous and osseous varus. Again, same thing in this slide. We have equal distribution of forces on the medial and lateral compartment. If we have loose lateral soft tissue, we can have more medial axial load. And if we have more medial axial load, again chances of osteoarthritis will be more even after ACL reconstruction on external adduction movement. Then what is the indication, correct indication for correction of varus deformity with ACL reconstruction? For me, if patient has medial compartment osteoarthritis and varus malalignment with ACL insufficiency, symptomatic anteroposterior instability, my indication for combined varus valgus osteotomy with ACL reconstruction. Again, second indication, medial compartment osteoarthritis with varus malalignment and failed ACL. First indication was primary ACL, and second one it was a failure of ACL. Third, again, if patient has significant visible varus thrust, double varus or triple varus with ACL tear, this is a combined ACL reconstruction with corrective osteotomy. And if I am doing concurrent meniscal repair, root repair with some mosaicoplasty, I prefer to do unloading of the medial compartment by doing a medial open wedge osteotomy. Now comes, it is all about genuvarum. It's something, any role of societal deformity with the ACL. Of course, now we have a lot of literature with the tibial slope, how this can affect the ACL surgery results. If we increases the ACL slope, of course, it improves the PCL insufficiency and reduces the recurvatum. If we decrease the slope, it improves the ACL insufficiency and reduce the procurvatum. And in 2017, this is three groups have in their study. They studied the non-contact injury of ACL and related with the how they relate with the posterior tibial slope. Uninjured control, the slope is around 7 degrees. With unilateral ACL, with non-contact injury, slope was 9 degrees. And in patients with bilateral ACL, slope was more than 10 degree. That shows we have if we have 10 degree more posterior tibial slope, chances of ACL injury are very high. Again, in this biomechanical study, this was a cadaveric study. What they did in this, they increases the slope from 5 degree, 10 degree and 15 and 20 degree. This was a computer generated study, and they concluded that at every 10 degree of increase in the slope, there is a more translation, 6 mm translation of tibia on anterior side. If we have 20 degree of flexion osteotomy, again you can see the translation get very high at 30 degree of flexion. That means that 0 to 30 degree is important with the slope in ACL biomechanics. This is one landmark study. This paper, Wang by Wang in 2019, they concluded they find three major findings. With intact ACL, anterior tibial translation of each compartment, whether is a medial or lateral, was positively correlated with the corresponding angle of flexion. Internal tibial rotation is again positively correlated with the lateral slope. If we have ACL sanctioned knee, anterior tibial translation of medial compartment was positively associated with the medial slope. That shows how we can conclude, what is the conclusion in clinical practice. That shows that under axial compressive loading, the medial and lateral tibial plateau slope is very important for kinematics of knee. It is not only the medial or lateral tibial plateau. again Webb in his paper that with posterior tibial slope of more than 12 degree, the risk of rupture after ACL reconstruction is 60%. That shows that we can have a 12 degree as a cutoff point for slope correction surgeries. Again, this is a paper. This was done in infinite model. They studied in 0 degree, 5 degree, 10 degree of posterior slope. And they studied how the ACL faces or exposed to forces. It is in 10 degree slope. You can appreciate that the forces was on ACL is 460 Newton. That shows that if it increased tibial slope, the chances of ACL failure is very high. How the we can is it is possible we can correlate the meniscus bone angle with the tibial slope. Of course, if we see this pictorial diagram, if we have more slope, then again the translation of tibia on the femur is very high as compared to less tibial slope. And how we can measure the meniscus bone angle? You just place a tangential line over here and one is on the cartilage surface. This is how you can measure the meniscus bone angle. And there is a vicious cycle. If we have more slope, again the tibia has more anterior translation over the femur, chances of lateral meniscal root injury or posterior horn injury is very high. If we have more posterolateral corner injuries, then again anterior tibial translation is very high, again chances of ACL tear is very high. Again, same paper, they suggested that meniscus has a very important role in giving you internal tibial stability as compared to ACL. How to measure or determine the tibial slope? This is how we can measure on the MR scan, and we can find out the meniscus bone angle over here with tangential line. We can have one perpendicular posterior tibial axis. One more is we have this on X-ray. It is simple. You just put a long lateral X-ray view with a posterior tibial axis, make a tangential line of the cartilage from the anterior posterior and measure the angle, what is the posterior slope. Average is 10 degree. Now comes how we can manage this. It is a open wedge high tibial osteotomy. It is a closed wedge high tibial osteotomy. Of course, it is a closed wedge high tibial osteotomy is a good one. Chances of failing is very high and it decreases the posterior tibial slope. The problem with the open wedge is it increases the posterior slope. Other disadvantage with closed wedge osteotomy is you have to be careful with the neurovascular bundle, you have to do the fibular osteotomy. But for me, I prefer to do medial open wedge osteotomy, biplanar doing differential opening of the osteotomy. If we have to decrease the slope, you can open on the posterior side. If you want to increase the slope, you can open it on the anterior half of the osteotomy. How to plan, how to measure the angle, how much correction you want to do, what you can do, you just place a line from, this is proposed osteotomy line, from 4 cm down or around 2 cm down from the lateral tibial condyle, and make a center of axis, make a center of femoral head. From intersection point, you apply this length over both, and this is what you require correction of osteotomy. Average we want 1 degree for 1 mm. I don't have patient of ACL slope correction. I can show you the PCL for chronic PCL insufficiency, how we did. This is a patient of chronic PCL injury. This is open surgery was done 5 years back. PLC was not done. Patient has again thrust with recurvatum. This is his x-rays. This is his scanogram. And this is MRI. What I did? I did decrease the slope, increase the slope by opening the osteotomy in anterior half by putting this plate on the anterior side. And because of this plate, I can manage this already placed screws because we have multivariable angle. And simultaneously, I keep the make the posterolateral complex also. This is what the Filippo, Laprad and Dozor, they just do the open to decrease the slope. They just do the closed wedge open proximal tibial osteotomy by detaching the tibial tuberosity. This is little bit cumbersome because it's you have to remove the detach the osteotomy, tibial tuberosity, then make a tunnel and then put it back. I have experience of increasing the tunnel, increasing the slope with this patient Lokesh, 21 year old male. He had injury 6 years back and the injury was unnoticed. On latest x-ray, he has a decreased posterior tibial slope. This is what his x-ray, sorry for the poor quality of x-ray. This is his knee. External, he has a little bit recurvatum with mild varus. And what I did the tibial tubercle osteotomy and open it to increase the slope. You can do with the same principle, we can close the osteotomy and reduce the tibial slope for ACL insufficiency and those patients who are at risk of, because of more than 10 degree of posterior tibial slope. This is how it gets healed. We have the modification by Peterson. They do subtuberosity osteotomy to avoid all this area to put the tibial tunnel in a beautiful way. Again, this is the same literature. The number of surgeries, the number of patients are very less. But in both studies, they showed that high degree of posterior tibial slope is risk for the new ACL. In conclusion, we should consider the bony deformities if you are planning a revision ACL, or especially sometimes you find in a primary ACL also. The problem with the bone, it can be double varus or posterior tibial slope. If we have for me, the indication for medial open ways osteotomy is failed ACL with lateral joint line opening with 5 degree of varus, and if I find in primary ACL there is a pain on the medial compartment that shows that the patient has arthritic changes, and of course if the patient has more than 10 degree or 12 degree of slope with recurrent instability, I will go for both simultaneously surgeries at a single sitting. Now question comes, do you advise slope correction in primary ACL? I have no experience and not much literature is there. The panelists can discuss with this. And of course, if a patient has significant slope, we can advise, we can discuss with the patient that you have chances of higher ACL tear, and especially if patient has contralateral ACL tear. And surgical technique, for me, I am comfortable with the medial open wedge osteotomy. I can open it in a differential way. It's if I want to decrease the slope, I can open it posterior. If I want to increase the slope, I can open it more anterior side. Thank you. Thanks for attention.
Thank you, Rajiv. We are in the middle of the program at the end of three talks. And we are a bit about 20 minutes beyond schedule, which might impinge on the discussion. So what I have decided is we'll push the discussion to the end of the session, so that I request all the speakers to stick to their time. I now request Dr. Prahlad Kumar Hingi from Preeti Hospital, Madurai, to focus on all inside, all suture material, all suture meniscal repair. Is it the next gold standard? Over to you, Prahlad.
Thank you, sir. I think so. The screen is visible, sir, no?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Perfect.
So after seeing so much of ACL and alignment, we will just come to the another important structure, that is the meniscus. So I will be focusing only to all inside technique of meniscal repair. So we all know meniscus is a very important structure. We heard in the previous talk by Dr. Rajiv. So how important this semicircular wedge shape fibrocartilage structure in our knee joint. So this firmly attached to the tibia by their anterior and posterior roots, as well as on the medial side, they have the capsular attachment, so it makes it less mobile when compared to lateral. So these are again made up of type 1 collagen fibers, which run circumferentially, and these longitudinal fibers are most important to create the hoop stresses, and they are interlaced with thin radial fibers, which helps in binding these longitudinal fibers. So we all are aware of the zones. They are very critical when you are planning for a repair. So the peripheral red zone are very good for the repair. The white and red zone is like, you can't take chances to repair now. The white zone is one critical. So where now people even advise repair in these zones, but it is still a matter of debate. So we all know meniscus increases the contact between the tibiofemoral joint. They act as a shock absorbers. They enable the joint lubrication, provide joint stability and proprioception. So these are the various tear patterns. I would like to confine myself to this posterior horn test, which will be repaired using all inside technique. So we'll just go through certain common tear patterns that they are like horizontal tears. These are most commonly the degenerative tears, where these tears run parallelly to the tibial surface. And these cleavage tears, they are also most of the time they are asymptomatic, and they can be either you can do a partial meniscectomy, the resection of the either of the flap, unstable flap, or you can do a repair by closing the mouth of the tear. So these tears are most commonly associated with paralabral cyst. So the longitudinal tears, they are very common tears following injuries in the young adult. They are most common association with the ACL injuries. These tears run perpendicular to the tibial surface, and they can be either a complete tear or incomplete tear. And when these tears extend to complete circumference, then they become a bucket handle. So this tear get flipped into the joint and form a locked knee kind of situation. So you can see here, this leaves an imprint mark on the cartilage, and it is sometimes called as the crescent sign. So this is another tear pattern. It is called the radial tears. So the radial tears are the most harmful tear or notorious tears, because they completely run perpendicularly, cut the longitudinal fibers. So the entire hoop stresses effect is lost here once you have a radial tear. And also the repairing of the radial tear is very critical. So you should have a very kind of special implants, instrumentations, or like things to repair these radial tears. So now we have seen for the past few decades, we have been moving from meniscus resection to meniscus preservation. The whole program is on preservation. So I will confine myself to all inside technique of preservation. So when we go through the literature, we have seen there is a very positive support which is in the favor of the repairs, particularly the bucket handle tear, the longitudinal tear, and the vertical horizontal tears. So this article by Buchel, they have they established that this repair for a longitudinal is a very promising technique, and this risk is worth taking, particularly when you are doing a repair with a ACL reconstruction. They have a very good outcome, and they give long-term cartilage protection. The Moon studies have also confirmed these findings. So what is, how do you do a selection that this patient you're going to repair and this patient you're going to do a resection? So there are patient factors as well as the tear characteristics. So the age of the patient, the elderly, you try to avoid doing a repair, and the young patient, and particularly the sports injury. Suppose if the patient is in the season, you try to avoid repair because of the extended rehab. So coming to the tear location, it is very critical. So you can, based on the location of the tear, the chronicity of the tear is again an important factor. The more, the older the tear, the less healing potential they have. So we have seen the various patterns of the tear, and stability is also an important criteria whether to repair or not to repair. So the all inside repair are confined to the posterior horn tears. So there are several devices which were used before, like staples, darts, tacks, screws. They were all very critical and they had a lot of issues. So later now we are very much using the self-adjusting suture devices like Fast Fix and Meniscal Cinch. So now we have seen latest is all suture anchors, that is a fiber stitch. So all inside repair is most easy technique. I can't tell it's most easy technique. It's definitely a useful technique which avoids injury to the neurovascular structure, accessory and an additional incision. It can reduce your operative time handfully. So what does the success of a meniscus repair depends, like any fracture fixation, it should be a stable fixation, and also you should promote a biology, that the biology for healing is critical. So when we plan for a meniscus repair, the positioning of the patient is again very critical. So when you are using a leg holder, the repair of lateral meniscus will be a little bit difficult. And also, you, to get a very good valgus for a medial meniscal repair, you need to do sometimes pie crusting of the tight medial compartment. You should have your good portals to have good visualization of your medial and posterior horns, medial and lateral posterior horns. So upgrading the meniscal ends, tear ends, is very critical to stimulate the healing. And at the same time, they have there are various suture configurations like vertical mattress, horizontal mattress, or oblique mattress. And they say that vertical mattress is more stronger compared to horizontal mattress. And they say the interval between the two anchors should be at least minimum 5 mm, so that they give good stability. So one critical point when you are repairing the lateral meniscus posterior horn is its close proximity to the neurovascular structures. Here, you have to be very careful. 0 to 3 mm from the PCL is a very critical distance. So whatever portal you use, so you have to be aware of these structures. So these are the various implants which were used for this thing, for all inside repair. So we will see this fiber stitch, which is all suture anchor. So we all know the technique. So you measure the meniscocapsular junction, then you take a bite, you load an anchor, then deploy the anchor. So you take another bite, you load the anchor by rewinding it back, and then deploy it again. And then you pull the suture so that you get compression at the tear. So by doing so, you can get a good fixation of your tear, repair of your meniscus. So all suture anchors, we are comfortable using all suture anchors in shoulder and hip surgeries, but there the literature supports for these injuries, for these anchors, is promising in shoulder Bankart surgeries and few cuff repairs, but their role in meniscus is very new. So we have to wait and see how they do in the meniscus. So this is one longitudinal tear, so of the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. So we have assessed the meniscus length, and then we stabilize the tear. Then we take a supporting device, guiding device. Then we pierce, load the anchor, deploy the anchor, and then you retrieve your device, and then take. Here you decide what kind of configuration you want. So I prefer to take a vertical mattress here. So went for the second bite here again. So, and then you tighten the loop so that you get compression of the at the tear, and then further compression by using a knot pusher. You can use a knot pusher to firmly tighten, and then use an arthroscopic scissor, and you get a very strong repair of this meniscus. So this is another case. This is again a complex tear. It was a segmental tear. So there was a white zone. There was a complex tear. So I preferred to debride this white zone tear. And then there was a long peripheral longitudinal tear. So I preferred to put two anchor. I decided to use two tacks. The sequence is you can use first fix the posterior horn or whichever is most unstable. So we did the similar procedure again here. Take the bites. So then you tighten the loop. Then repeat the same procedure again here on the posterior side. So we did the same procedure. And then you see this meniscus repair became very strong and you are not able to bring it back into the joint. So it has become a very stable construct. So the take home message is meniscus preservation should always be considered. All inside technique gives excellent repair option for the posterior tears. The tear pattern and associated injury influences the outcome. All suture anchors are simple, stable and strong. They are biomechanical and we need more biomechanical and clinical studies to prove its gold standard. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity and patience here.
Thank you, Prahlad. Now I request Dr. Samir Ali Parvat from Calicut to enlighten us on meniscal ramp lesions, how to find them and how to treat them. Over to you, Samir.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Kiran, for your kind words. Around 25 to 30 years back, the place for a damaged meniscus was near the bucket of the surgeons. Now, further we moved into the repair of the meniscus, then we, as far as our knowledge and biomechanics of the knees improved, we more concerned towards the repair of the root, then the new things is the ramp lesions. So what is the ramp lesions? In 1988, the Straubel described this as a meniscosynovial or a meniscocapsular lesion of the posterior medial meniscus. So there is a medial meniscus, there's a capsule, and between there is a synovium. So either it's in the synovium or a meniscocapsular lesion. So why the ramp lesion is something very important? Because the posterior horn of the medial meniscus is considered as a secondary restraint to anterior tibial translations. So definitely these lesions are going to affect the stability of the knee. And many of the cadaveric studies have shown that in an ACL deficient knee, if there is an associated ramp lesion, there is a 2.6 millimeter of excess anterior tibial translations. So this is one of the reasons for an exaggerated pivot shift test in any case of the ACL deficient knee. So any ACL deficient knee, if you come across in a grade 3 pivot shift test, you should look for a ramp lesion. So this ramp lesion can occur either at the time of injury or as a result of the chronic ACL deficiency. And seen in around 16% of the patients with ACL deficiency. And it's more common in males and those who are under the age of 30. And definitely, even the patient doesn't have a ramp lesion in the acute episode, but over a period of subsequent instabilities, the patient can develop a ramp lesion subsequently over a period of time. So this is the basic anatomy. We just described this meniscus is there, this meniscotibial ligament and the synovial membrane is there. So depending upon the injury level, it is being divided into five types. Type 1 means it is a capsular meniscojunctional tear. Between the capsule and the meniscus, if there's a tear, it's a type 1. If the lesion is confined to the superior half, there's a partial tear, then it's a type 2. And if it's involved inferior part, inferior or partial tear, it's a type 3. And if it's a complete tear from superior to inferior, there's a type 4. And if there's a double tear, then it's considered as a type 5. So why is it important? So whenever there is an ACL deficient knees, if you have an increased anterior tibial translation or there's an excess pivot shift test, you should vigilantly look your MRI if there is any evidence of ramp lesion. How you look at the MRI? In such view, you can see this is the lesion. The posterior horn beginning with the capsule and the periphery of the meniscus, you can see the tear pattern. So you have to look for the ramp lesions rather than the reporting of the MRI. And many of the time, if even though MRI is inconclusive, you have to look for a arthroscopically, you have to see whether there is any ramp lesions. So immediately after putting the anterolateral portal, before putting an accessory portal, you have to see, you have to look for the ram lesion, because you need to distend the joint to see the posterior compartment. So the interval for you, so this is a knee, which is an the knee has a chronic ACL deficit, the ACL is absent. So this is the interval. So this is the interval you have going to see. This is a between the medial femoral condyle and the PCL. So these through small gap, you have to skew your scope very softly to reach the posterior compartment. So here you are going to see the ramp. So this is how a normal tissue you have, you will see. Sometimes it will be very difficult to see with a 30 degree scope, the ramp lesions. And if you have an opportunity, you have to use a 70 degrees scope for the better visualization. Or if you don't have a 70 degree scope, then better use a high posterior medial portal. So this is a view from the high posterior medial portal. You put a posterior medial portal, keep the knee external flex. This is a ramp, or it's a normal synovial tissues. And this is a tear. So you can see when the knees extend and flex, the tibia move more anteriorly because it is being separated from the capsular tissues back. So whenever you have a doubt, you have to see from the high posterior medial portal, or you have to use a 70 degree arthroscope. And many of the time, even if the ACL is intact, but it is a degenerated ACL, you can have a ram lesion. So how significant is MRI in diagnosing the ram lesion? MRI has only a moderate accuracy in diagnosis. So almost always, if you have a doubt, you have to arthroscopically, you have to see the ram lesions rather than completely depend upon your MRI. So what are the important trips you have to consider when repairing an ram lesions? Most importantly, you have to create a good high posterior medial portal. Once you have created a good posterior medial portal, this is the ram lesions. Even with a needle, and then you have to freshen up the edges so well. Either you can use a Bungard straps or you can use a shaver, but don't put it in oscillating mode, put in a forward or a reverse, so it won't take out much of the tissues, because the backside is always the tissue is very soft. Should be very vigilant when using the shavers. And once it is done, you have to take the bites using a clover hook, whatever it is. Always, it is, we find it's very difficult to take bites from the posterior tissue because that is very flimsy. And after that, once you take the bites from the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, you should be very careful about you have to avoid injury, because we are close to posterior horn, posterior part of the posterior medial femoral condyle. So depending upon the tear length, you can put one or two sutures might be required, because in this type is a big lesion, we put one and then the same another one more medial to this. So this is about initially we have find it very difficult to take bites from the synovial tissues. Now if you start to use the knee scorpion, it's a very good instrument to take bites in the posterior synovial tissues. So the same pattern, we have to put a good posterior medial portal. We have to debride the tissues. And then first we take the bite using an acupass or something. You have to take the bite from the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. Then shuttle the suture with a number 0 fiber wire and load the fiber wire and use the knee scorpion. Knee scorpion is a very good instrument to take bites, especially from the posterior flimsy synovial tissues. And make sure that your knots are stable, at least 4 or 5 alternative stitches, and changing the pose you have to do as you are well wished with the shoulder press. And in some cases like type 1, type 2 and type 4 type of injuries, you can use all inside devices. And this is, we have put a 2 stitches. And this is a view with a 30 degree scope. And once we change the this 70 degree scope here, we use, you can see the all around the back, you can see the tear. So always, almost always, you have opportunity better to use a 70 degree scope for the better visualization, even for the diagnosis also. And now the question comes, is it necessary to repair the stable ram lesions of the middle meniscus during ACL reconstructions? So it is a 2017, the Sue et al. Have concluded that stable ram lesions can be treated with abrasion and trephination alone during ACL reconstruction, results in a similar clinical outcome compared to those treated with a surgical repair. So make sure that these are stable, and you should abrade if I have to make the area freshen. And a lot of BMPs, the bone morphogenic proteins, marrows will come into the ACL reconstruction. That's also will stimulate the healing. So there is a role for conservative management for ram lesion provided if it is stable. And most importantly, the rehabilitation protocol. You should have a postoperative brace, and patient have to keep for a non-weight bearing because it's almost like a root repair, non-weight bearing for 4 weeks. Crutches should be there for 2 to 3 weeks. Gradually range is around 70 degree till 2 weeks. Will reach 90 degree by 4 weeks, and usually the full range of movement by 2 months. And usually the isometric cords will start on the day zero onwards. The stationary bikes and cross chain kinetic exercises can be started after 2 months. And usually return to running and slight jogging by around 4 to 5 months, and full return to sports as usual by around 7 to 8 months. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Samir Ali. That was a very clear description of meniscal ramp lesion and the techniques for its identification and repair. With this, we go to the last topic for the day, that is knee osteochondral defects and their management by Vishnu Prasad Patrao. He's a head of the department in AIIMS Bhubaneswar. I request Vishnu Prasad Patrao to speak to us on knee osteochondral defects and its management.
Good evening, all. Is my screen is visible?
Yes. Yes, Dr. Bishop.
Thank you, sir. So today I will be speaking on knee osteochondral defects and its management. So after 5 extensive talks, the last talk of the day, to start with, what is a defect in the cartilage or the bone? Accordingly, the name has been prescribed. So defect in the articular surface of bone with different depth of injury. We know that the cartilage is strong connective tissue, which can withstand frictions for decades, but once it is injured, it cannot repair itself. According to the depth of injury, it can be a chondral injury or an osteochondral defect. In chondral injury, the cartilage injury has intact underlying bone, but in osteochondral defects, the focal area of the damage involves the cartilage and the underlying bone. The etiology most commonly is due to trauma. There could be cases of osteochondritis dissecans. Degeneration also occurs in the older people. The malalignment, as the speaker had already told, also contribute to the etiology of osteochondral defect, and inflammatory arthritis has also its own contribution. The presentation of the persons with chondral defect, mostly a back pain to start with. There could be episodes of repeated effusion. The patient has unexplained effusion, and later on they found we have a osteochondral defect. There could be episodes of synovitis. The pain could be at rest, or it could be at the time of activity. Because of the pain, there is stiffness of the joint, and it leads to decreased sports activity. The evaluation of this condition just needs meticulous attention. It doesn't need any extra investigations. We can go for an anteroposterior lateral tunnel view and skyline view of the knee joint. It will reflect because most of the defects are near the trochlea and the intercondylar notch. And MRI, a fat suppression view, gives a better result. And we must not miss the coronal view. The coronal view gives the maximum presentation of this diagnosis of osteochondral defect. People have tried with SPECT, but it has no added advantage. It is more of an academic purpose. The chondral damage has been classified by outbridge, and later it has been modified. It's 1, 2, 3, 4. Basically, you can say that 25%, 50%, 75%, 100% of damage of the cartilage. And the ICRS also has classified this, but it's according to the depth of cartilage which has been damaged. And it is 1, 2, 3, 4, according to the severity of the damage. Osteochondritis dissecans is a partial or complete detachment of a fragment of bone along with cartilage. It has also four grades. Arthroscopically, when there is softening of the cartilage, no definite fragment, it stays one. Articular cartilage bruised and fragment not displaceable, it is two. And articular cartilage bruised, it is three. And once it is loose, it is the stage four. The management has two types, non-operative and operative. Non-operative has its own limitations, but people have always tried because if its outcomes are grimy. So the first and foremost non-operative management is rest, the physiotherapy, protective weight bearing, capably tied with some medicaments. And there are some 100 molecules are available to claim that there is regeneration of the cartilage. And hyaluronic injection also have some own effect. Coming to the operative procedure, there are many procedures and there's an exhaustive list of operative procedures. And every morning you will find a new procedure. It shows that none of the procedures work, so that we look for a better procedure every morning. Coming to the operative procedures, it extends from the joint levels, average chondroplasty, microfractures, autograft transfer, it could be mosaic plasty or what's, fresh osteochondral allograft, ACI and collagen scaffold. Many have been their stage of research. The joint levers is basically removing the loose bodies, is a clearing the debris, removing the inflamed synovium. But the results are similar to that of a placebo. Rather, it induces infection. It relieves the pain for a couple of weeks, but mechanism of action is not clear. So we are not sure whether to do something or do nothing. It's up to the surgeon. Average arthroplasty or microfracture is one of the most commonly performed procedures because many times it is an incidental finding. And at that point of time, we don't have any other instruments rather than this microfracture. So during going for an ACL or meniscal repair, we find there is a damage to the cartilage. And at this point of time, we have to go for this particular procedure. This procedure, the objective is to recruit pluripotent stem cells from the marrow by penetrating the subchondral bone. So we want to regenerate the cartilage, but the penetrations gap should be 1 to 2 millimeters. There should be protective weight bearing for 6 weeks. And most of this space is covered by the fibrocartilage. Because the fibrocartilage is not that strong enough, it may last for only 2 to 3 years and wear in with further friction. People have tried with hyaluronic injection and literature also supports to give hyaluronic injection following average microfractures or arthroplasty. It is indicated for lesions less than 2 centimeters and the correction of limb alignment is also an important aspect while dealing such lesions. Osteochondral autograft transfer, it could be mosaic plasty or OATS. It's just the mosaic plasty needs multiple pieces and OATS will like less number of pieces. Mosaic plasty is preferred for lesions up to 2 centimeters. It's always harvested from a knot varying zone, the lateral to the trochlea or the intercondylar notch in the knot articulating part. It can be done open or arthroscopic according to the expertise of the surgeon. But arthroscopic is technically demanding. Many times arthroscopic are converted to open procedure at point of time. It's ideal for small lesions and better results than microfracture. It has dominated the market for a couple of years and later on it has been replaced mostly by the OATS. The OATS is a promising and rewarding procedure. The difference from mosaic is the size of the osteochondral graft is wider and thicker, so better penetration to the host bone. And there is larger bone plugs, it's a good coverage. It could be almost around 10 millimeter of the single plug and technically better than mosaic plasty because many times there is delamination of the cartilage over the chondral bone of the graft during the harvesting and implantation. But with this larger piece of this graft, we have a better chance. And I have used this Arthrex OATS procedure and it works very well. And we can go up to maximum 2 to 3 centimeters of defect. Allograft is a future prospect. As of now, it's not available in our place and is the feasibility is a concern because it has to be done within a very small span of time. So whenever the patient get a chance that there is available of allograft, the surgeon and the patient, the recipient has to be on their toes because they have to complete the procedure in a very small span of time. But I presume it's a promising in the future and you have to wait its outcome. ACI is the present thought of the people and many places there is research is going on ACI and few centers, few companies have just got approval for this ACI in India. And it is suitable for larger defects, but the most important is restrictive permission for the government. The cartilage is harvested from a knot weight bearing zone and sent to the culture and it is once is cultured is applied with a fibrin glue. It needs two surgeries and it's very expensive. But the minimal result as of now has some good results, but we have to follow protecting weight bearing. The long-term results are weighted and we have to see how the future works like. Osteochondral fragments, if it is small, just we can remove with a sever and you can do some microfractures. But if it's a bigger one, then you need to fix it. We have to clear the crater and remove the fibrous tissue and fix with either screws or pins. It can be a metallic screw or pins, or it can be a biodegradable ones. But removal of the hardware, like a metallic one, depends on the surgeon with follow-up x-rays. And it can be done both open or arthroscopic as per the skill of the surgeon. In a recent literature in 2020 in the EFORT journal, he has compared the multiple procedures for condyle damage. And he found that the microfracture is generally unsuitable for treatment of larger defects, which is more than 2 to 4 cm². Osteochondral autograft transfer wards has been shown to be better than microfracture, but it's technically difficult, demanding. Osteochondral allograft is again a problem with the permission and also the time within which it has to be done. ACA has shown some good results and has created hyaline cartilage, and the rehabilitation almost takes 12 months. There is also a feature for autologous stem cell transplantation, but at present its role is very less. Another study has seen that, has tried to compare comparable studies with the scaffold, the collagen scaffold. The one study has shown that 3D collagen scaffold, it gold medium term clinical outcome in knee osteochondral defects. At the same time, another study has shown that in a span of 2 to 5 years, the outcome is not that significant. Many patients have some good results, but the MRI is not appropriate. So basically, this scaffold also needs some further time to give a answer to our questions. And another study which also shown that the biomaterials for osteochondral degeneration has also been shown to give good results. And the results are stable at midterm follow-up. As of now, we have a basket of solutions. But if you look for the ACL reconstruction or PCL reconstruction, they are countable because we know that each method works better. But in the case of osteochondral defect, as none works better, but in my hands, I feel that the OATS was the better. And in smaller cases, when I don't have a OATS, the next option is a microfracture. So there are many procedures available with us, but one technique is presumed to be superior than the other. And no technique is applicable for every patient. The results are different with different hands because of the stiff learning curve of different procedures. And the cost of the procedure is also a matter of concern. And it is not free from complications. So as of now, we feel that we still need to evolve to the next level. We need to look beyond the tunnel because at present, I present what works the better, and ACI can prove the future whether how it will be possible to work on a larger defects. With that, I thank you for kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Vishnu Prasad, for the exhaustive coverage of knee osteochondral lesions. Now we head for the most interesting part, that is the discussion on all the topics. Nagraj?
Yes, Kiran sir, tell me.
And Clement? Yes. First, we take the questions on ACL related topics. All inside ACL. Any questions from the panel or from the co-chair?
I think I'll go first to Dr. Tejasvi. Nice talk. With respect to all inside ACL, do you have a algorithm as to when you select specifically all inside ACL? What is your algorithm in terms of how do you select all inside ACL, or you do all inside ACL for most of your active adults?
Very nice question, sir. Actually, I wanted to discuss the same thing with the panel. For me, all inside ACL is never predetermined. Most of my cases, I go with an open mind for doing the conventional technique. But when I harvest the semitendinosus first, if I think that the thickness of the graft is too small, where I most of the times we triple the graft. If I think that the diameter is less than 8 millimeter, then I automatically convert it to an all-inside technique, because as you know, we get a thicker graft of with the smaller length. So this has been my algorithm till now. There is no fixed thing. And most of my revisions, I prefer to, if the previous tunnel is in a totally wrong position according to me, and if I have to create a new tunnel, I don't care to remove the existing hardware, and I go with the all inside technique. This is what I have been doing till now, and I would like love to hear what others do as well.
I think Dr. Clement can.
Yeah, it's a good technique, but I think you have to consistently do this to be familiar and finish in a time. But I think now we have an understanding that you need to have a quadruple semi-T. But the problem with using bioscrew is your fixation and the cancellous part of your tibial tunnel is not going to be great. It can easily slip in the post-operative stage. You have to have another cortical fixation, tibia. If you are doing the conventional technique, my choice would be to use a button fixation of the femur and to prevent the graft tunnel movement, bioscrew inside. If the graft is not coming all the way out, probably I will add another fixation like a button on top of my tibial tunnel or a second bone tunnel and tie over the cortical bridge. So this is a kind of philosophy in my practice. I don't do all outside because it's the instrumentation is a bit, you have to be doing all the time. It has got its advantages if you have an obese patient where if you're doing an inside out femoral tunnel, your wire is going to go all the way into the thigh and it can exit too high, even beyond the tunicate. So I think those cases where you can make an incision and place your outside in femoral tunnel is really helpful. But otherwise, I don't see much. If you follow the principles of using additional fixation, if the graft doesn't come to the cortical opening, I think both these techniques can give you the same result.
Like I said, if you have a very tight fit on the tibial and femoral end, and it is a very snug fit graft where you really have to struggle to pull the graft into the intra-articular area, which kind of gives you a very, very snug fit in femur and tibia. A lot of fixation issues, get sorted out. And then with a cortical fixation, which is quite tight, even without a screw, a lot of times in more than 50% cases, it does work out, especially if you don't want to, if you are protecting your ACL, like the braces in cases where you surgeons routinely protect their post ACL for a week or 2 or 3 weeks. Most of the times in non-athletic population where demand issues are not there and concomitant other instabilities are not present, you may actually, I have a large series on a single cortex fixation, which is usually done in most of the cases by most of the surgeons, more than 2,000 of them, and it has actually not shown much difference in having, if you have a snug fit. So Clement, your thoughts are well taken, and I have the same views when you have about a millimeter or two of space in between the graft and the tunnel with fixing the screw and adding a cortical fixation. But if it is a very tight fit, sometimes I just put a endo button, a suture disc or something at the tibial cortex and just tie the graft on that and just leave it. I mean, it works equally well. This is besides the topic which we were discussing.
Thank you, Dr. Vigal. Just add a small point.
Indications for all inside have been well delineated now, and initial most complications which are reported were all related to technique, which is true for any technique described. Once you have the learning curve in place and you are comfortable with the technique and you have the hardware frequently being replaced, not reusing the same flip cutters, then the complications are less. And you should remember that all inside, you need to be very, very clear about your diameter, like you said. And you should also remember that the grafts tend to swell up on the preparatory back table, when, especially if you are soaking them with an antibiotic. So you should have those blocks in place so that they don't swell up and they maintain the diameter. These are the important tips for all inside. Yes, good discussion indeed. Any other issues?
Couple of things. I can go ahead. Yeah. As you said, sir, I think it is very important not to reuse the flip cutters. I had a couple of things where the flip cutter broke when I was drilling the tibial tunnel. Then I had to use a button extender because I can't convert it to a cortical fixation because of the short length of the graft. So we need to have, I always have button extenders on standby in case this happens. And second thing is, I find using the compression tubes, actually, I think that I don't know whether they're available here. I bought them from when I was doing my fellowship, and I find it very good, and I leave it inside. This does not allow the graft to expand and mismatch of the tunnels that I create. So these are two things that I would like to add, and I agree with what others have to say on this.
Yeah. I'll just add a point.
Yes, so
for me, all inside ACL, the flip cutter, the outside in drilling are various modalities in our armamentarium to make sure that our ACL reconstruction matches that particular patient's anatomy. So the first thing for me is to do the diagnostic round to check for the ACL footprint, if available. Is it a very large footprint? Is there any remnant there? Then, as Dr. Tejaswi mentioned, look at the grafts of the patient. Almost always I'll end up using both the grafts, a 6-strand or an 8-strand, even in some patients. The outside-in drilling, I would agree with Dr. Clement, it is especially reserved for the obese patients. It makes your life very, very easy. The only difference with Dr. Clement is that I do use dual fixation on the tibial side. However, I place the nitinol wire in such a way that I visualize it intra-articularly. I place it in to my desire with a mosquito clamp. I get the bioscrew all the way in. There is a chance that it might still rotate in spite of all these efforts, in which case I would use a dual fixation. And the fact that you can visualize the screw right at the subchondral surface, the tip of the screw, you know that the entire length of the graft in the tibial tunnel is fixed by the screw, even if the graft is slightly countersunk. So these tips have helped me to, you know, recreate the anatomy of the patient.
So, yes, Clement.
Yeah, the next indication would be if you are doing an ACL with ALL reconstruction in case of a high degree of rotational stability. Many times we end up with having a tunnel coalescence on the lateral aspect of the femur. If you are already decided that you're going to do ACL and ALL and you don't want the tunnel problems, you can expose the lateral epicondyle region first itself, and you can have an exit point for your ACL tunnel slightly below the level of your lateral epicondyle. And then you can have your ALL tunnel slightly above and posterior to the lateral epicondyle. So this would be a very practical use for the outside in drilling for the femur. If you are treating a revision case or a high degree instability or a sports person where you want to do both ACL and...
Your microphone is switched off, Clement.
Was I audible at the time?
Yeah, at the end.
ALL with outside in drilling. Also, I think bucket handle meniscus, lateral meniscus tears in pediatric group, you can take the incision, you can do your inside out repair, and you can do a fascial sparing outside in drilling. That's another last indication where that 30-60 guide, outside in guide works very well.
Yeah. So, Clement, coming to your bracing, the internal brace which we use for the MCL reconstruction. So post MCL repair and internal bracing, or augmentation of MCL repair with internal bracing, would you still tend to use an external brace after your surgery?
Yes, I use a simple hinged knee brace, but I am not worried about the patient not using the brace and the knee getting stressed during exercises. So still I use a hinged knee brace in all my cases, but I'm not sure that I can, like how Gordon McKee does, allow them to weight bear. We are still conservative about that. This is just an added protection, hinged knee brace. But when you look at these hinged knee brace which are available, many times they don't fit properly with the knee. There is still an amount of medial lateral laxity which you can produce inside the brace even after applying the brace. And also our females, they especially vary in girth. A lot of times they don't tolerate this hinge knee brace very well. So I think it is one guarantee inside that my internal brace is going to support the knee, whether the brace is going to fit properly or the patient is going to comply with the bracing. In most of the cases, I don't think the braces, the hinge knee braces, that gives that kind of a very tight support that we need following an MCL reconstruction.
So that was exactly the point. If we have done an internal bracing with which we are happy on the MCL or an ACL post these two surgeries, then how much is the real rationale of giving an external brace? A. Number two, that my concern has now started coming up since I don't know how many of us are re-scoping our knees after the bracing enough. Whether there is a stress shielding of the graft or the ACL which we are doing, and whether actually I've done it for some commandos, you know, I've asked them to come back to, because they don't have to pay and the government pays for them. But eventually, it is important to find out whether there is enough literature on stress shielding of the grafts, whether these grafts actually degenerate following the internal bracing and the effect in long term. I feel
yes, there is
osteoarthrosis of knee because it is a static construct now. So there is no stretch in the graft which happens naturally and it leads to extra stress on the knee which can lead to patellofemoral or medial compartment arthritis.
Yeah, that's a concern because as you have seen in my video, I keep a hemostat under the fiber tape and then I tighten this fiber tape independent of my graft fixation. So this is like a seatbelt effect. In normal physiological loading, the fiber tape internal brace is not going to give any stress shielding to my graft. But if the physiological loading is kind of crossed, there is a valgus stress. Probably at that point, the fiber tape is going to come into play and protect stretching or tearing of the graft. Similarly, when I do ankle ATFL also, you do ankle, the Brostrom repair with gold modification, still the combined Brostrom repair and gold modification tissues strength for at least 2 to 3 months is much, much less than the native ATFL. So even after 2 months, you're not sure that your ligament is going to stretch out. So you add an internal brace, but don't tighten to the level of your ATFL repair, but just keep an artery forceps and leave it slightly loose. So it is not going to protect or stress shield your graft, but when the ankle is going to go into inversion sprain, that's where it's going to stop. It's like your seatbelt. The seatbelt is not always applied tight to your body. It's there, but when you are thrown out, it's going to come and hold you. So this is how we do that. For example, if you're trying to do, I don't do ACL internal bracing for my ACL reconstruction, but I tend to add a good amount of graft most of the time. But if you are going to add it, one suggestion would be that you add, take the tape through the button, okay? Not through the loop. Take the tape through the button and then you fix on the tibial side, maybe slightly, you know, lax, but over-drill the femoral tunnel so that you have 5 to 6 millimeter more. Then the final tightening you can do by cinching the roof so that only the graft will tighten, but the fiber tip will not get tightened. So that the final tightening of 2 to 3 millimeter you can give only to your ACL graft, but it will not going to affect the tightening of your internal brace. So this is one technique I kind of picked up, but I've never used in my cases. So this is kind of a differential fixation of the internal bracing and the graft. The graft is always tightened slightly more than your internal brace. So in ACL, you can achieve it by adding the fiber tape to the button rather than to the loop of your adjustable loop. Yeah.
Just one final quick rejoinder on this bracing. It is a very static construct. So eventually what happens is that in a high demand athlete, the flexibility issues, after they have reached a point at which the brace starts restricting their the muscle, the external, our quadriceps and hamstrings and in ankle, in the peroneals, they have you found patients with high demand who kind of create secondary problems in their sort of with muscle tears and
I don't know. In the first cases where in a few years ago when we used to tighten the internal brace, I've seen irritation, soft tissue irritation, where in one case I have to go after 7 months to remove the brace. Then I realized that I should not over tighten the graft. So we depend more on biology, then keep it as a restraint. So I don't over tighten. So in that particular case, I had over tightened my MCL internal brace. The patient became all right. It was ACL, PCL, and MCL injury. But the middle side of pain continued. So we had to go and remove the brace. Apart from that, ACL internal braces, whatever I've done so far, they're not given any trouble. And MCL reconstructions alone, we always had laxity postoperatively. But after adding the brace, I'm much more confident of moving, not at facing any problem so far.
For MCL, I agree, always brace. I think that is a very, very important addition to our armamentarium.
Vikash, we need to proceed to the next topic. Yes. The Rajiv Gupta's talk was quite extensive. And if there are any specifics on limb alignment surgeries?
I was very surprised to see Dr. Rajiv talking about osteotomy in grade 3 lesions, I believe, what I could understand from his talk. And it is very brave. He's a complete limb preserver, it seems. No belief in replacement surgeries at all.
Eventually, yes. Eventually, they will all come back for the replacement.
Yeah, because that was a...
But if the lateral joint is fine, there is still an indication.
I think he mentioned 3-compartment surgeries in one of these talks. 3-compartment arthritis also. So, Dr. Rajiv, would you like to say something?
Yes, man. Dr. Vikas, the issue is... it's a combined diagnostic scopy, then planning of STO. And the age of patient, what you discuss, I think it was the first patient, age is around 38, female. And every patient, whether it is a primary varus or it is a double varus, I think it is they are going to come for TKR, no doubt. But we have to be preserved and taken them to the at least respectable age. And what I showed the patient of female 38 year old with that is one patient was not opening on the lateral side, that is primary varus. And important thing is in that patient, the damage on the cartilage was on the posteromedial part of tibial condyle. That means it was a grade 2. And one of my patient, again, same female, age group, of course, BMI was high. It was 40. She was 42. The damage on the femoral condyle, and again, it was not a specific lesion. For that, I can do microfracture. It was a geographical damage on the femoral condyle, but subchondral bone was not exposed. That was not in the MRI also. That's why the indication was absolutely right for doing valgus osteotomy with ACL reconstruction. And whatever it is we are all agree that every such type of patient will going to have the TKR replacement in future. But important is to make them right now good, painless quality of life.
You have a very extremely good technical hand. I can see that. I mean, congratulations for that. But when you do an open wedge medial osteotomy, and you are trying to do a slope, posterior slope. So you are anteromedial, you are putting the plate, right? But if you want to reverse that osteotomy, suppose you want to reverse that osteotomy, in that case, how would you go about a medial opening wedge osteotomy and where would you put that plate?
With the medial open wedge, we can play both ways. We can increase the slope, we can decrease the slope. As I do initial cut with the blades and then I use the osteotomes. Okay. And it gives me some space to change the tilt of the condyle. If I want to improve the slope, I mean is increase the slope, you just open up on the anterior side. If you want to decrease the slope, you open up the on the posterior side and remove little bit cortex, because as I do use osteotomes, that I can have the some margin to get that play.
So if you open up on the posterior side, how do you hold with the plates which you showed?
With TKR instrument, that is laminized spreader.
The concern is the superficial MCL. That's what I was thinking.
Why MCL is concerned? So superficial MCL, we can, we just,
we can. I'm just asking a technical question, just clarifying.
No, there is no issue with the superficial MCL. Even I don't erase the superficial MCL, some surgeons do. I just cut it because my osteotomy start from just above the presensorus. And I just use a cautery, it remove the superficial. I think it doesn't bother me at all.
Can I just come in?
Yes, Nagraj.
So that's a very good discussion we have initiated. That is patients who are probably chronic ACL tears or ACL re-ruptures in the presence of medial compartment OA with or without significant malalignment. A few thoughts of mine and then a question to Rajiv. So typically when we do a medial opening wedge osteotomy, we do a thorough release of the superficial MCL. That's the first guiding principle. The medial opening wedge osteotomy by itself has a tendency to increase the tibial slope if you have not released the MCL especially. So in order to counter that, you have to open up more posteriorly than anteriorly. That is the norm even in a regular non-slope correcting medial opening wedge osteotomy. That is the only way you can actually maintain the slope of the patient. So as Frank Noyce has said, your anterior opening has to be half of the posterior opening. Then you have not altered the slope. The question comes, like Rajiv said, how do you titrate your osteotomy when you want to consciously decrease the tibial slope? That means you need to further open up more than that half rule. Only then you can further reduce the slope. Having said that technical input, my question to Rajiv is, let us say you have a chronic ACL tear patient who comes to you with this posterior medial wear. He does have some amount of malalignment. He does come to you with pain. He does come to you with instability. We all know we are going to offer him a high tibial osteotomy with an ACL reconstruction. My question to you is, when you do his measurements, you realize that his coronal malalignment is minimal. So his medial proximal tibial angle is within the normal range. However, you would still offer an osteotomy because there is medial compartment wear and there is pain there. How do you titrate your osteotomy? Meaning, how much would you open? How much would you increase your MPTA to? So as we know, 85 to 90 is the MPTA. He is in the normal range. You want to offload that compartment. To what extent you would be comfortable increasing his MPTA without changing the joint line congruence?
If patient has more complaint about the instability, I will keep my center of rotation will be in the intercondylar notch. I am not going to cross the midpoint. If patient has arthrosis on the medial compartment, I will follow the classical 62.5% of tibial plateau. Regarding if patient has ACL with normal joint tibiofemoral alignment, we have to look for the posterolateral complex also. If patient does not have any bony morphological problem, then it is a soft tissue. There is a combined ACL with PLC. If patient has bony problem, it is a classical primary varus and the joint line is coming near to close to 30% on the medial compartment. Classical 5 to 10 degree we can calculate and we can bring the center of rotation in the intercondylar notch. If patient has medial weight bearing axis coming towards periphery, it is more on the medial side periphery, then again you have to keep in mind and you can calculate the osteotomy angles by some major scales and lines and then do the osteotomy. And what is it? I am okay with your
I think
we are clear.
We have had a very, very strong discussion. I think I'll just take one more question and then we would have to close at 5. I think that is the upper limit of this unfortunate this thing which we have got. And
I think all suture meniscal repair, that I expected it to generate a good discussion.
A lot of it, yeah, both of them.
Because meniscal ramp lesion was so clear, and the technique also was described. All inside, all suture meniscal repair. What's the experience with the panel and co-chair and other speakers?
I have started using it lately, and I think it's a very good device. And the ability to titrate your tension, like Dr. Prahlad showed, the first step being when you pull on the loop, so you have that initial compression, and then you can actually titrate your compression with your knot pusher. I think these are the slight advantages over the traditional device where you really do not have that much amount of control. is a good idea. And the very fact that there is no material, even if it's a small peak material, however, here there is no particular implant, so to say. It's just a suture ball, and we are all comfortable with a suture ball in the shoulder. So I think these are the distinct advantages which we have with this device.
True. True.
Okay.
So the early reports are encouraging, and it's only the matter of technical excellence and a learning curve. And with the any new fixation device coming in, we need to have a collective discussion and share our thoughts in these forum, and so, then go ahead.
Yeah. So just one quick rejoinder: are we all doing radial tear repairs on this panel?
Yes. We will not say all radial tears I do. It depends on many factors. Yes.
Yes. So that would not be a choice of, repair of all the repairs. I would rather maybe 50-50 on that. Clement, what's your take on this?
Yeah, definitely. I would weigh in against, too much adventurous in the tears. But definitely, I will do a little bit of trimming of the inner third. Then probably I'll use a fast fix or the new device across this thing. And also in horizontal, so that there will be a rip stop kind of a pattern. Whatever you do, these tears have a high chance of failure. Yes. So simple side to side suture should be added by peripheral fixation also. Yeah.
Yes, Kiran.
I think a good discussion on table with the patient having a biofeedback in these cases would be ideal. You show him the tear and you explain, and then take a call, and then you always tell him about the possibility of a re-entry later if it fails. Those things matter the most. That one thing we learned from our peers is the biofeedback is the best feedback one can have with respect to arthroscopic surgery.
On table, the only answer you get is do what you think is the best. I have never got any better answer than that. I don't know how you manage to get any other answer. So eventually, it ends that way.
It's basically putting the ball in their court, you know.
which rarely has any. So yes. I think, Kiran, all of us have to leave. Now it's 5
yes.
o'clock. We have overshot by 1 hour. I would leave the honors to you, the course chairman. So thank you so much.
I thank Neeraj and Team Arthex, Avana, and all the panelists, all the speakers today for making this happen on a Sunday evening and a fruitful discussion. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.